Unless you are the parent of a Canvas student. student in K-12. But here's what you might want to consider, and I am going to encourage you to get the student app if you don't already have it. You will be able to do things like take a look at your Directed Canvas course or any course where you're enrolled as a student, and you could also participate in it if in any courses you're enrolled as a student. But a lot of instructors, a lot of teachers like the student app because they can see what their courses look like to their students. So even if they are the teacher of a course, if you access it through the student app, you're going to be able to see what your students see. Now the Canvas Teacher app is also going to be a really great thing for you to have. The Teacher app was designed for you to be able to manage your course. And by manage, I mean you can't build anything new in there, like you can't build content, but you can post announcements. You can publish or unpublish. You can change dates. You can communicate with your students, and especially what folks like in the Teacher app is the grading piece. So you're going to be able to do all of your grading, has full access to the speed grader through the Canvas Teacher app. So you can really be grading on the go. One of the things I've ever had to go to that I thought was the most boring thing ever for my niece is a soccer game. I think little kid soccer can be I think little kid soccer can be really boring. It's a great place for me to get caught up on my grading. I do a lot of grading too, like in airports, because I run some courses, and then you know I'm sitting there waiting for a plane, and I can get my grading done. So you can still do all of the great feedback. You can use rubrics. You can do audio, video comments, and it's even easier through the Teacher app. And we were talking at lunch about if you have a Canvas or if you have a If you have an Apple Pencil, there is support in the Canvas Teacher app for the Apple Pencil. So I would encourage you to get the student and the teacher app. You do not need the parent app. I know that you guys have iPads, but this is a chart just to let you know that the Canvas student app does work on all devices. So does the teacher app and parent app. They used to be wildly different depending on which platform you were using. That is not the case anymore. You can see that there's parity now across no matter what they're using it on. If it's on a phone or a tablet, and I know you guys are on iOS, your students can do all of these things there, which is great. I want to talk about the way Google is going to work, though, with your student app. This is going to be really, really important. Because you guys are a Google school, like, correct me if I'm wrong, all your students have Google accounts, right? So they can access Google Drive. Do they have the Google Drive app installed on their iPads? Okay. So, Canvas and Google will talk to one another, right? You've seen how that works on the in the web browser. The same thing will happen on their iPad. So as long as they have the Google Drive app and the Canvas app, the two things will talk together. Now, I don't know that we've spent a whole lot of time talking about how the Google integration works inside of Canvas, but these are all of the ways that it's connected. You can see Google Drive in your course navigation. Cloud assignments is huge for students with the Google Drive, right? So we can create a cloud assignment and have a copy of that assignment in the student's Google Drive. A lot of you have tried it's a file uploads where students can upload directly from their Google Drive and then house SpeedGrader. So there's actually these seven ways that the Google LTI integrates with Canvas. And again, all of these slides I put in the course so you can look at it. So Google also works with collaboration modules, and you'll see that Google Drive symbol in your rich content editor. So because it really is like such an integrated piece of how you're going to be using Canvas, especially if you have teachers who already love Google Classroom, this is going to be an easy, this will make sense to them that the two things work together. I need to point out how it's going to work with the Canvas student app. So you'll notice that there's two columns there. One says things that work well now, and the other column says things are being improved. So we are on the almost downside of this. All of those things are almost ready to be in the column that says things that work well now. Canvas worked with Google to create the Google integration, the LTI that currently exists. They got a lot of feedback from K-12 districts like yours, who are also Google schools, that said, hey, that needs to work better on things like iPads. So this winter, Canvas and Google rewrote the LTI. We have some districts who are currently testing it to do the things that you're seeing over there that are being improved. So let's talk about what this list says. If you put Google Files anywhere using that Google integration in your Canvas course, students will be able to view it as long as they have that Google Drive app also installed on their iPad. So it should not cause them an issue. You can also easily display Google Drive external links in your Canvas course. You'll notice over there that all of those other things are currently being fixed. Now, by the time you guys use this in the fall, these will be a lot better. Right now, if you made a Google Cloud assignment, students would be able to see it in your course. They would be able to click on it in the app. And what it's going to do is automatically put a copy of that assignment in their Google Drive. So that's where they would go to work on it. They would actually go into their Google Drive app. And then when they go back into Canvas, they'll see a submit button. And the Canvas app and the Google Drive app talk to one another. That workflow at first for students is a little bit funky, right? Because you have to access it one time from your Canvas app, and then know that you're gonna go work on it in your Google Drive. Now, because it's funky, that's why that's being rewritten. And I think that by the time you guys can come back for the 2019-2020 school year, this might already be totally resolved and rolled out for you. The other thing that you see right there is that students can submit in Canvas a file upload submission, something that lives in their Google Drive, as long as they have that Google Drive app on their iPad. So shouldn't be an issue. They'll go into the Google Drive, they'll see three dots on the right, and they'll click on it, and it'll say open with Canvas Student, and it'll open it up in there. So as long as your students have both apps, they should be fine. Like I said, these workflows aren't awesome. Canvas heard that from K-12 schools, so they're rebuilding it. This slide, like all the other ones I've showed you today, is in the Grindr's Canvas course that you all are in. So you'll be able to take a look at this. And then of course, when I hear that that's been re-released, I'll make sure that your admin team knows here. So that we might not even have to bring this up to students. Questions about that? Both of those things are being improved. So we're going to talk next about the differences with if we know students are using primarily the mobile app. We do have this document here, which is I'm going to scroll past. We have a mobile app design considerations. These are some things I'm going to tell you about. To think about when we know that students are using a mobile app. Things that we should think about using because it's really going to help them out. And you have seen a course created like this. This is how we've created the Growing Your Canvas course. So in that course, you've seen things like this. We use text headers to show students where they should be working. So all a text header is in a module is just a way to guide student navigation. So if you are looking, for example, at, let's see, we'll go to Growing Your Canvas. You'll see that that has those text headers in there. That might not seem like that's super important. There's nothing a student has to do, but that will guide them in the mobile app to where they need to be and where they should be working. Just pull that up, point that out to you. Where we're seeing these words right here, this is what a text header is. And so it's just giving the students kind of like a subheader inside of a larger module. I'm going to scroll down here to the last module. You'll see that I've included them in here for today. So like this is the part of the module we're working on right now. So it's just like a little subheader. That is something, it might not seem very important, but in the studies we've done with how students use mobile devices, this is really important for their navigation. So that's one of the things to think about, because we know that students here are going to definitely be using that mobile app. Probably the biggest thing, which we are all teachers, so we understand why this is important, is to chunk content, right? A mobile device has a smaller screen, and you're gonna have to scroll more quickly to get to the, because your screen is smaller. So what we talk about frequently when we're talking about mobile app design and chunking content, 2,000 words max for the thing that you're creating is probably a good idea. If it looks like whatever you're building is getting long, you can go ahead and break it up into another page and put that in your module. Because remember, once you're in a module, and let's say, you know, I'm on this item, you're going to get the next button at the bottom of the module. So even if you had, bad example, even if you had multiple pages in for your content, so like right here, we'll start here with 1.2. This is a page, has a bunch of content on it. I see that it's getting long, so I break it up into another page, and when the students click the next button, it's like turning the pages of a book. So we try to avoid creating pages that have all of the things on them, because students don't really love having to scroll a long way. We have to remember that because they're going to have that smaller screen, that scroll will happen a little bit more quickly. So this is just an example of, this is a really long page right here. And then breaking it up then into multiple topics, it looks a little bit more like a table of contents. Students can access the thing that they need to get to more quickly instead of trying to find that in that really, really long page. You know, when we create something, when we're teachers, everything we make is really important. We want our students to read. But if we put too much content on a page, there's no way they're going to see it because they're just going to start tuning it out. If we do smaller pieces, which I'm sure you're all aware of, you know, smaller chunks makes it easier for students to just take in. The next thing is, when we're creating modules, the best thing to create when we're talking about for a student, because we know we're going to use the mobile device, probably the best canvas to build it on is a page. The reason why, you can link to external URLs and you can link to files in the modules. The best thing to do though is to design it right on a Canvas page. That's going to provide the best student experience. So I would always suggest, even if you do have a file or a URL that you want students to go to, I would create it on a Canvas page and use the rich content editor that Canvas gives you in order to do that. That is because Canvas is, if you build it on a page, that's native content in Canvas. So it will scale to the right size on the mobile device then. And then it will use all the correct tools and coding that Canvas provides. yes, we can just put links to places inside of our modules, but the best experience will always be provided on a Canvas page and using that rich content editor that Canvas gives you. So here are three screenshots of the exact same thing, just to kind of show off what I'm talking about. That first thing is how that article looks as a Word file. The middle page is how that would look as a PDF. And the last page is how it would look if I took that content and copied and pasted it and embedded it onto an actual Canvas page. All of those three screenshots were taken on an iPad inside of the student app, and you can see which one is the better student experience for the student. It's the actually using that editing tool inside of Canvas. Okay. We know then that students here in UC Everest are going to be using the mobile app. So one of the things that you need to know is that the submit button changes in the mobile app. In the web browser, the submit button for students is going to be in the upper right-hand corner. That is not where it is in the app. The submit button is in the middle of the page. So here's all you have to do. Don't say where on the page the submit button is. That's it. That's what this means. Instructions and prompts are platform neutral to minimize student confusion. So don't click on the submit button in the upper right-hand corner to turn your work in. That's not where it's going to be for students in the app. It's in a different place. So we're just gonna, that is probably the biggest difference between the web browser and the mobile app, where the submit button is. So here's the screenshot, what that looks like. So that first screenshot is how turning in an assignment to a student looks in the web browser. And the one on the right is how it looks in the mobile app. So they actually have a submission tab. So we're just not going to refer to exactly where it is. We're going to put those in our instructions. Most file formats will show up for students in the mobile app. The one thing that won't is Flash. So most places aren't using Flash anymore. Just try not to use it. If you can't get around it, what you can say, what we recommend to teachers is tell them that would have to be accessed on in a web browser and not in the mobile app. I don't think you're going to run into many file formats that aren't supported anymore. This is just a screenshot of what you can say to students if you had something like that. This one is very interesting. One of the things that we've talked about before when I was here with modules is that if you put requirements on modules, it checks it off for students so that they know where they stopped working. In the mobile device, that really does help the students out. You can see in this screenshot, the one on the right, this is just a page that I wanted my students to do. And one of the requirements you can use is mark as done. So even though there's not something that you need students to turn in, they still have a button to click so it feels like they did something. So they're gonna click mark as done. And then you can see in the right-hand screenshot that what it's going to do as you're using those requirements is check off for students with those green check marks so they can see where they left off. That's really helpful if you have a lot of modules in your course or if you have some modules that are super long. They're going to be able to tell right where they need to go and right what they, you know, what they need to do next. A lot of people, when they use requirements, you can use them for things like setting a baseline grade or that they have to turn something in before they move on. But you can just use them. You could set them all to mark as done, or you could set them all to view. And it will still check them off for students. Just knowing that you guys, you know, have have iPads and that most of your students will be accessing Canvas this way. I think that's something that you really could consider trying out with them, make it easier for them to use it.
Mary?
Yeah?
Do you have a way, like a report that you just can look at to see where kids are at?
Yeah. Do you already know the answer to that?
No.
Oh, okay. I thought maybe you were like, hey, Erin, show us this tool. All right. So in this is the course that you all are in. I am using them in here. So I am using requirements. I have requirements set on them. What I'm able to do then is I can click this View Progress button. You can see that on the modules page. Okay, I'm not going to embarrass anybody. And then what I can look at is, where is everyone? Where are they right now in this course? So I can see that this student has completed these modules, and they're right here then in this module, and these are the things they're still need to hand in. So it's a really easy way to see where everyone is. And that only will work if you use those requirements on the module. Otherwise, that button doesn't do anything. Really good question. It's almost like I planned to do it, but I didn't. Perhaps.
I'm looking at the intro module on here, mm-hmm. and I can see it. I can see it on my phone. I can't see it on the iPad. Like, I have a white screen.
Hmm.
That not, yeah. Are you, what side are you in? Are you in the student side?
Yeah. So teacher side of the
Yeah, that's right. I'm in that course right now, so I didn't know if
you can't see the intro. None of the stuff is in the intro.
Good job. Good job.
No, not when I put next. I didn't know if there was something in particular I was screwing up. It's a me problem.
I doubt it. It's a me problem. We'll check it out. You might have found a bug. That seems unusual, especially if you can see it everywhere else and then you can't see it. So we will check it out. Sorry about that. I'm not
going to blame
you for that. So what thoughts, and if you've been looking at, I know hopefully yours is working better than his is. If you looked at the course through the student app, are you noticing any differences or what thoughts are you having about, trying to show you what the differences are between the two things, but what are your initial thoughts about that? Because the way you're creating content to build, building it for your students is going to look slightly different to them when they're using it on the app. Do we have any concerns about that? Felicity just said yes, but I don't think it was me.
Nope.
Okay. Good design of a Canvas course is going to flow over really nicely to the mobile app for students. Probably the biggest thing to think about is just how long those pages get, right? So that chunking will be really important just to help them kind of take in all that good content that you have. And just because you can put like an article and an image and a video and then a piece of audio all on one page, Canvas will let you do it. But if there's 10 things on there, how many things do you think the students are going to see before they're like checked out? Canvas has done a lot of studies with students and how they use mobile. So the average student length of time that they'll spend looking at a screen, they'll spend looking at Canvas on a laptop is how many, anyone want to take a guess how many minutes on a laptop at any one time before they're like, it's a little bit longer than three. It's 13. Who said 13? Oh my gosh. So the Canvas studies say that a student on a laptop will interact with Canvas for about 13 minutes before zoning out. All right? The Canvas mobile studies that they've done then is if that student is now on an iPad, that is reduced to 9 minutes. All right? So you've got them for about 9 minutes at a go. And if they're on their phone, right, smaller screen and more distractions, lots of other things are coming through, right? Snapchat and whatever else, things I don't even want to know about. I'm really bad at Snapchatting, by the way, because I'm old. But they're getting all these other things, text messages, and they don't get phone calls, right? That's an old thing. That time on a phone then is reduced to 4 minutes, okay? So we've got these limited windows, so we don't want to create these big, long pages with all this content on there. We know that all these other things are vying for their attention. Let's talk about the Canvas Parent app. Has anyone ever used the Canvas Parent app? Do we have any parents of students in the Canvas district? Tried?
No.
Oh, okay. Oh, you didn't get like the parent code?
Right, yeah.
Okay. Okay. To get connected? We're going to fix that part. Yeah, we're going to fix that part. But what about, has anyone else tried to use the parent app? All right, so this is all new stuff. What the parent app looks like, use some screenshots of the parent app. One of the nice things about the parent app is once we get connected, if we have multiple students, we are able to swipe through and see different students. So if I'm looking up here at the top where it says Jessica Doe, and she doesn't have a picture in there, if this was live and I swiped either to the left or the right, I could switch to my other students that are also connected. So that's really nice for the parent app, because I will tell you, that is not what it's going to look like to them when they get logged into Canvas on the web browser. If I have 3 kids and they're all using Canvas and I log in on my laptop as an observer to their courses, and all those kids are in high school, I'm going to see my dashboard with all of their courses for every one of my students. So it could be potentially, you know, like 15. 16 courses, and it's a lot to handle if I log in on the web browser that way. But in the app, I have really easy access, so I can look at Jessica, and then I can swipe, and I can look at her brother, and I can swipe, and I look at her other sister. And I can choose different colors for them, and make it a little bit easier on me as a parent. What the parent can see in the parent app is super limited, okay? They're gonna be able to see the courses that the students are enrolled in. So we're seeing that over here. These are the courses. They can also, if they click into any one of those courses, that's what that other screenshot is there. So if I clicked into that intro to, or the history course here, and I clicked into it, what I can see then is the week view. So I'm able to see everything that's due in there, and I can click on those things that are due, and if it's an assignment or a quiz, I'm just going to see what the instructions are. Can't actually see whatever that assessment is. So the parent view is limited. I'm going to be able to see things like dates, names of things. Notice that parents can set a reminder if they want to be reminded that there's something big coming up. So if there's a big test, parents can get a reminder sent to their parent app that that was happening. So they can look at courses and grades, which is not going to be important for you guys. And then they can see assignments. And the other thing they can also see is events. So if you're using the Canvas calendar and you're putting events on there, things like don't forget to study for a test or bring your sneakers for field day, parents are also going to be able to see that on whatever day you put that in. So they can also see events that you put on the calendar. This is a really nice communication tool. This one, I don't know how much this will be helpful, because those grading tools for you guys is not going to be important. But that assignment missing notification might be. That's something that parents can turn on. They get notifications, alerts sent to their parent app when an assignment is missing. They can also, this is the other one that your parents would probably find important, they can get notified of course announcements through the parent app. So that announcement space, just like the events on your calendar, that can become another way that you can communicate important things, not only to your students, but also to your parents. So, seeing that, what questions or thoughts do you have about the parent app? Very high level view. Some parents will really like that. They don't have to log into Canvas on their laptop, but they can still see things like when are things due, when's my son or daughter having a missing assignment, and what are the course announcements. Other thoughts or questions?
Just one thing to note is on the, you see the grade there, it says A and that it has a percentage. Part of this customization, because the app is built by a different tool, they are not able to take that away from the parent view. So it will still have a percentage on there, but it will have the grade on there, the letter grade. So that's one thing that we were not able to get fixed as well.
So I can see there being some communication that's
correct.
Needed with parents, probably at a district level, about what the app will be useful for. Right, because those nice customizations that you're, what Diane is saying is those customizations that are being done through the web browser, because the mobile app team is not customizing that for you guys, that's one of the things that will definitely persist over here. So I think there's a way that the district can still message it appropriately.
We just have to make sure that the messages match what we want.
Yes, for the grading schemes, right? Now, the difference between the mobile app, though, for parents, the parent app, and the parents also will be able to access Canvas through the web browser. They're going to be enrolled as observers. So the observer account for them is going to give them a really deep view when they log into Canvas on their laptop or their computer and not using the app. They're going to be able to see everything that their student sees. So not only can they see the directions for assignments, like they can see in the mobile app, they're going to actually be able to see the assignment and how and what do the students need to do and what are these submission options. They're going to be able to, you know, see pages and all the other great content that teachers are creating. They can't submit anything, but they can see everything that their students can see. So announcements, calendar, they're going to be able to message student or message their own student and all of their students' teachers. And they can also see everything that the student submits. So they'll be able to see what the students have handed in, and they can see feedback that comes not in the app, but if they log into Canvas through their laptop, they're really going to get a really good picture of what's happening in the classroom, how is their student doing, and then, of course, they can use it for communication. They can't communicate with other students, and they can only communicate with the teachers of their students' courses. So we have mentioned then of having some difficulty connecting students to parents. So I'm going to work with your admin team here about what are some great ways to help parents do that. The parents will sign up for an account through Canvas. And then they need a pairing code. So this is where that little hiccup comes in. A couple different people can create those pairing codes. So the students are able to generate those. And we've got some great resources to tell students how to make that happen. We can also make it a permission that teachers can generate those pairing codes. And then teachers could give those to parents. Admins can always generate pairing codes, so if a parent did call up and request access at a very high level, an admin would be able to verify that that was true and then give them access. They're good for 7 days after they're generated, and the parent has to actually input it through the web browser. So they can't access Canvas the first time through the app. Once they have done this process by going to their laptop or their desktop computer, they put in a pairing code and they pair up with their student or students, then they can use the parent app and they'll automatically be connected. Canvas will recognize them as a user.
Right. So I can see a lot of parents using the parent app on their phone, and I'm guessing they don't have a computer. So would they have to have help setting that up at school the first time then?
They might. Sometimes that happens at a back-to-school night. I've seen a lot of districts do it there. Or they might have some laptops set up and they do it, or they could always do it on their phone through the browser on their phone the first time too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they can do it through. I should have, I'm used to saying the web browser, but they have a browser on their phone, so they could do it through there first, and then they can download the app. But a lot of places do have it at back to school nights or get to know the teacher where they're giving them this information and getting them all. Really good question. All right, any other thoughts or questions about that? I know that this sounds daunting, but I've got a lot of really great ideas that I'm going to give your team about how to make this easier, right? And then they only have to connect with their student once, and then Canvas will recognize them even the next year. Oh, you are that student's parent. Go ahead.
So if they have more than one child,
each student has their own pairing code.
But as a parent, will they see all their kids in one?
They will once they've paired up with all three of you. Yep. So I would get a pairing code from each one of my kiddos, put them all in, and then I'd see them either all at once in the browser, or like I said, in the app, I can switch them between my kiddos. Yeah. All right. Other questions or thoughts?